I'm going to open the public hearing. This is a continuation of a review from May 11th for the New England Urban Senior Living LLC for new construction of 62 units of residential building with 9,000 square feet of ground floor commercial use and associated parking structure at 10 Holly Street, Northampton. Map ID 32A 170, 171, 197. And today is Tuesday, September 6th. This was advertised?
So it was advertised originally for May, and we don't re-advertise once there's a continuation to a date and time. So
thank you. So we'll start by asking you to give us a presentation of the project.
Oh, yeah.
Can I just, for one second, excuse me, number de Goggins, and I just wanted to disclose to everybody that Mike Sacenti and I know each other. He is a business, Green Home Solutions, that and it is completely separate from this project altogether, and I just wanted everybody to know that we know each other and have worked together in that respect.
You're not representing, your company's not selling condos or anything.
Seems like it's been a long time. I was a year younger, actually. I had birthday in August, so.
Happy birthday.
We're going to go back through the slideshow real quick. There's some things here at the beginning that you've seen before, so I won't stop unless you want to, but I think mostly the focus tonight is Mike took some fairly copious notes last time. I listened carefully to what you were telling us that you had concerns over. And we went back through the standards that are written for downtown and decided we'd take them as literally as we could in the front. So that's mainly what we're going to see. Also, last time, I think it was fairly embarrassing laying all the materials on a chair seat for you to look at, so we did get a piece of foam core and some Velcro. So there's a couple of you that weren't here, so I guess I will touch on the fact that I think it's relevant to some of what we're going to say tonight, that this building is predominantly housing. Probably 85% of what we're going to build is housing. There's some retail that we're putting in the front, and there's going to put, and that's excluding the conversion of the existing church to a restaurant. So everything up towards Holly becomes retail and storefront, but up above it and immediately behind it, it's all senior independent residential. The plaza that we're putting out in the front is in part because we felt that our building should set back further than perhaps the storefront on the sidewalk kind of idea, even though that's what we've done 100% of the time in our other communities. So that this building, especially people approaching from Bridge Street, would not, the view of this church restoration or renovation in front wouldn't be blocked by our new building. So that's where the plaza idea sort of came from. And we're excited about that because I think some very fun things for that neighborhood on that side of the tracks could possibly occur there. But certainly it will also be a major attraction for our residents. They love watching people and watching things down the street. During the course of their stay with us, which can be 10 years, 15 years, their ages change, their mobility shifts just a little bit.
I'm sorry, I'm going deaf in my old age and I'm having trouble hearing you.
You said that last time, and I will crank it up. Our residents stay with us 10 years, sometimes 15 years. So over the course of that residency, their abilities to walk into this part of the neighborhood and get out of the building changes a little bit. So that plaza and the things that may happen down there on the street level would be incredibly entertaining to them. And I'm going to bring that up again after this formal part of the presentation of the changes we did make. Too many slide-ins here. We skipped this stuff. These were samples of buildings done in other cities and other states. The parks might or might not comply with what we're doing here. That's the outline of the property, excluding the street that's actually included in that outline. Phillips. Similar diagram on Google, and the reason we are here on that site is because of the fact that it's in the Central Business District and it's proximate to all of the excitement and activity and services that people can access easily as pedestrians. These are just a couple shots of what's existing at the moment. That facade of the church would remain and be a key focal point on the plaza. We hope to indicate some through signage or some kind of placards out there, some of the history of that whole neighborhood as a neighborhood, and also of the church with its repurposed restaurant. This is the other side of the building, not as exciting. We're doing quite a bit to try to create a buffer on that side so that residents moving into these nice new little apartments won't be looking at the loading dock for the post office and a good deal of asphalt there. These are just a couple of other buildings immediately nearby. We're not, unfortunately, in the heart of the downtown district. This is a side view on Phillips and kind of a corner angle there. And then these are some additional shots of buildings in the downtown. The elevation that you're seeing down at the bottom there has been revised so that two things. We at the very lowest level there, left corner, lowest level, we had pulled our retail storefront back 12 feet at the ground level. Our thought was we would create kind of a covered walkway there as access to the shops. The thinking was that if it rained during some kind of little concert or event on the plaza, there would be a place of refuge to get out of the rain. We've now moved that storefront out to the front, so we gained a little bit of retail space, and so that void is gone. Also, up at the very top, fourth floor, same corner, we had pulled back anywhere from 8 to 12 feet to create kind of a plaza level at the fourth floor. And I'm going to come back to that point a little bit later. Let's get these. So that revised this drawing, got rid of that plaza on the top. Storefronts. Now it's a little hard to tell without good shadowing on this, but those are out flush with some articulation stonework at the base. And the actual door is recessed with kind of a 45-degree angle piece of glazing adjacent to it, similar to, you know, a lot of the storefronts that occur up there along the main street. The plaza is a very key feature for us, and both for public use and resident use. That's the revised front elevation. We tried very hard to get rid of the triangles and the circles and the arches and other fun things we had introduced once upon a time, and to try to find our way back to a pattern that seemed to be more in keeping with downtown. So that's those two elevations again, both north and south, revised to reflect those setbacks and those changes. This drawing didn't get to take it as far as we would like to in SketchUp, so there's a lot of detail really missing here, but the purpose of this was to show a street level view of the building from over towards Bridge Street. And then the upper one there is to go jump up to a bird's eye view of the same drawing. our mechanical equipment is typically, each unit has its own individual air conditioning, so they can control their destiny and their bill. And so those things kind of line up down the corridor in the middle of the roof, and then we have parapets all the way around that should be plenty high enough to hide that from pedestrian view, and probably higher than needed in other places just to give variety to the heights of these storefront carrying elements. Our materials in front of you there, there will be a lot of brick, a lot of stone, potentially some precast. We will have more than one brick color, and you can see that reflected in the goal, at least, of the elevations all the way around the building. We're going to try to break it up into different size chunks of facade. And one of the ways we do that is with color change. There will also be some material setback or offset that occurs. And on the south elevation particularly, and towards the back, there will be some larger offsets that occur in that facade in order to allow apartment sizes to change in a somewhat significant way. So our smallest apartment is typically, say, 625 square feet in a one bedroom, but it'll go up to 800 square feet. There might be one in between even. Two bedrooms do a similar thing in order to be responsive to the different needs for space that people have and their financial resources, and to effectively offer what the competition does around us. So, and a fair amount of color change. Now, there's some stucco type panel represented there. Those typically go up at the top, fourth floor kind of thing, to again change material, help with offset, and to add a little bit more color variation than we get with the brick. You can kind of see that the brick is going from dark to medium to lighter, and then, well, you can't tell in those second two, but lighter and then lighter again. So some of that color change you're seeing in elevation will be brick change.
Is any of that banding, or that's just...
Well, this, the precast and the stone is what we typically use for sills, headers, and banding. And we have a lot of banding. If you look on the elevations, and I have an enlarged set if you want to look at them, but we're trying to break up the massiveness of this with facade and horizontal changes of color and material. So the banding is part of getting that done. That summarizes the things we've changed since you saw it last. Now, what I am going to show you here is that this may be a little unconventional, but we want to try to make a suggestion that because this building isn't right over here in the heart of town, it's in the periphery. The buildings over on that other side of the tracks are not as intently perfect as they are in other parts of downtown. And what surrounds us, although if I were you and I had adopted a design standard, I'd say, well, that's all great, except that we don't want to encourage more of some of that. We want to encourage more of this. And so I agree completely with that. But coupling that with the fact that we have this resident population that, unlike other age groups, any other age group, will spend more time in this building than most other people would normally do, we would love to have you consider the possibility of allowing us to step that fourth floor back 6 to 10 feet or so, so that there's the ability to have a plaza space up there that everybody living in the building, all those people way back at the other end, can come out into the front, walk out onto that plaza, and overlook and see downtown Northampton and all those activities going on the street and in the plaza. I don't know if that sort of thing happens within your standards, but it's something we'd like you to think about as you consider the presentation tonight. And if you were to say that you were comfortable with what that's doing, and I can send one of these around for a better look at the slide maybe, but we have two sets that we brought with us dated today that can be given to you and or Carolyn so that you're clear what you're saying yes to or not saying yes to, but the appearance of the building will remain pretty much the same from the front. But as we all know, three-dimensionally, when you look at it, there will be an offset up there if we're allowed to do a plaza.
And you have a 3D view of that?
3D view. No, we didn't draw it that way because we felt our base presentation view was going to be to fix what you told us to fix and then ask about the... I actually probably do if we could find the old... in the earlier presentation, there were several.
That setback wasn't.
Yeah, but in the original package, there were several, there were some SketchUp views and elevation drawn of it looking exactly like that, moving forward for that. Now that looks good. And I gave strict instructions to the guys in the office to purge all of that, including the plan view.
Flip to another page. I don't know what that's called yet. I probably would have been in the presentation.
That is the two side elevations with the plaza back in there at the front. So it'd be just enough space for people to come out to a railing out there. There might be some planting along the edge, and there might be an umbrella. There are very few balconies or plazas like that in your downtown. The hotel has a little bit, and there's some tack-on things that have happened here and there that look scary as I'll get out to walk out onto. But
fire escapes?
Well, it doesn't go anywhere. There's a couple of metal ones up there. Don't go anywhere. They're just...
I think the building on the corner that's adjacent to the post office, across from the roofs, I think they also have some balconies on some rentals that they have up top.
Yeah, and that one's...
So that's what we'd be doing. So we should probably...
Is that it for your presentation?
I think so.
Okay. So I'm going to open it up to the board to discuss.
Well, I, of course, would be happy to comment on this. I think that my biggest concern is with the building facade that is adjacent to the church. I think you've addressed some of the issues that I had, that you were sort of stretching, trying to come up with something, and I think it was overextended in your previous presentation. Could I just see the sketch that you proposed this time?
Do you have that for the
original one? Yeah, no, the little bit bigger one.
The proposed
east elevation.
And looking at
this is with balconies. This is without balconies.
Right. This is on the way to the buffalo. This is what we're talking about.
Yes.
Right now. Okay. I have no problem with the balconies up there. Just from a design point of view, I think you're wasting an opportunity with this central element of the facade, in that I would consider perhaps a little bit more articulation, almost creating a pilaster effect coming up to give it a little bit more business. And also, I think you have a real opportunity here, not for something, you know, that's fancy like a full round cornice up there, but just a little bit of articulation, perhaps a shallow curve, because to me this looks like it's just been chopped off. It's been decapitated, as opposed to giving it something that would you know, just give it a little bit more of a crown. But I think a little bit more articulation here, maybe just some lines, what you see here, but not really mimicking it. But take advantage of the brickwork that is.
Well, I think we were trying to be a little too influenced by this church facade instead of sort of, and I think philosophically not doing that may accentuate the facade of the church more than what we originally had over there. We have some degree of problem functionally, though, in taking this particular building, unlike maybe some of the ones that are here in town, because our corridor runs right down the center of the building. I already don't know what to do with some of those windows that I introduced in there for you, because they're going to be right in somebody's bathroom or kitchen, or, you know, it's just going to be an issue. So we're going to have to get creative about all six of the units that get affected by what we do there on the facade. So I'd rather not get too complex in the middle with punched openings and windows. The curved part at the top, I had no problem with that.
Yeah, I'm really not talking about punching more openings, but just perhaps, you know, running a line or reveal the difference of, to create a shadow line.
Well, it does project out a little bit. I don't
right,
know if that's clear on that.
I'm looking for something that would be
along the window
here.
Line. Okay, sure.
And then a little something up here.
Yeah.
Give it a hat as opposed to a truncated neck.
Right.
Anyway, other than that, I think that this looks much nicer than the original proposal. I think the
hope so. I had 2 months to work on.
A little over the top.
Were you just referring to, in terms of the privacy issues, of the units that would be potentially looking out onto that upper plaza? Is that what you
were referring to?
You were just referring to there was an issue with privacy issues of
kitchens,
bathrooms, and windows. I just missed that.
Well, I'm just saying that we don't tip, our corridor goes down the middle.
Right.
You enter in, and then there's bathrooms and kitchens lined up right off the corridor. So you get down to that end wall. Typically, we have bathrooms and kitchens bumping up against the end of the building. So to put full-blown double windows into those spaces creates an issue, because if we kept the scale of the windows as they are, somebody's going to have a 6x6 window into their bathroom or their kitchen or both in 6 apartments. And so we purposefully did not do it on the second level for that reason. And then we introduce windows up above, and we'll have to figure out how to deal with those within the apartment layout.
Just in terms of the format of the meeting, are we going to systematically go through these guidelines?
I have some comments on those.
Yeah.
If there's any general comments. I'll jump into the nitty-gritty. So as before, we kind of just went through the guidelines to check on each of the items. So guideline one, building setbacks, we talked about the plaza, and I think it's a great idea, and it sounds like the planning board granted that, so we're not really going to discuss it. The building height and width, it appears that you're meeting the requirements of being at least 30 feet high and 2 stories above the street. That's not an issue. New theme building facade height should generally approximate those of adjacent buildings where feasible. As you noted, you have not too many buildings that are regular.
We got a little spot over there.
Right. So, I think that you're meeting what's required by the intent of the guidelines. So it talks about new theme buildings which are wider than tall should be visually divided on street facades into one or more divisions, each taller than wide. And it appears that you sort of have this three bay structure happening in the front. I think what Bruce was bringing up a little bit is it's not quite clear how well articulated that center bay is. Does it? We don't have floor plans, so we don't necessarily know what the setbacks are of that. It talks about the possibility of defining it by piers, and if you provide piers, that they should be at least 12 inches wide and 4 inches deep. It doesn't seem like you have piers, but I think, to me, the three-bay division is sufficient, although in your final documentation, I would like to see floor plans so that we can understand the setbacks and the facade.
I was shying away from doing a lot of setbacks because of some of the feedback discussion last time, but I favor them as long as the proportions are right.
How far out does the middle bay come?
Well, at the, you know, it could be, it's up to you. It could be a...
So you have...
A full eight. We have not drawn or designed the interior, but it could be a full brick width, eight inches. It could be more than that. As far as I'm concerned, it would be easy to bring that down to the ground, all the way down to the ground if we wanted it. But that large amount of articulation, I don't see that in downtown. Even one building to the next, they're pretty flush. So we do some of it with color, material change.
Well, I would argue that there is actually articulation. It may not be as deep as 8 inches. It might only be 4 inches, but it's enough to produce a shadow line that breaks up the facade. So even understanding the depth
of that.
That's
easy to do and very comfortable.
The roofs. So what we request is that roofs for new theme buildings should not be visible from the street. And should be screened by raised parapet walls and decorative cornices. So it does appear that you have parapets and cornices. We don't have a roof plan, but I see in your 3D views, it looks like you're gonna center the mechanical systems on the roof. So like right there,
yeah.
It likely would not be visible from the street. Guideline 6 is about building articulation.
Can I just mention something?
Yes.
But you can see the roof on one of the garages, it looked like to me.
But not, can you see it from the street, I guess, is the question. That's what I was unclear about, so where this was. Where is that view?
Well, the garage is this way to the rear.
Okay.
It's like
so it's not
beyond the post office.
All right, that's
way up.
Okay.
Building articulation. So new buildings or additions may be articulated by means of bays, which you are using, turrets, recesses, columns, large arched openings, designed in a stylistically consistent manner. I think, similar to what Bruce said, it does feel like this next pass of the design has brought it more stylistically together or consistent.
It has too many flavors.
Yeah. It's not bland, but it definitely has more of a cohesive nature to it than it did last time. And I do think that it's compatible with other downtown historic buildings. As you noted, you have some banding. You've also articulated the roof line or parapet line. And I think that that's nice, and it seems, again, that that's a little more simplified. I don't know that I agree 100% on what Bruce was saying about the center bay having an arch at the top, but I also feel like you're not quite at that detail level yet, so I'd like to see a little more details on what.
Happy to bring that one back two different ways if you want. It's already in the CAD system.
Okay. First floor facades. Guideline 7, first floor street facade of theme and anomaly building should have at least half of their surface in clear, non-mirrored, non-opaque glass. And the bulkhead base wall should be built below the first floor glass and should not rise less than 12 inches, nor more than 30 inches, and it appears that that's what you're complying with. Again, there's no details, but it looks conceptually like that's what you're trying to achieve. The theme or anomaly street facade should have at least one doorway every 40 feet, recessed at least 36 inches from the sidewalk. We don't have any dimensions, so I don't know how wide that front facade is. Ideally, it's about 80 feet.
Well, the front facade is, no, 60. The building
okay,
will
so
be about 60, 62 feet wide always.
So you're meeting that requirement.
And there are at least two storefronts with each with a door, or perhaps even another one in the middle of that center bay. And then as it turns the corner, there are several more on the side.
Windows, guideline 8. So this is for upper windows. Again, I think that you listened to what we asked and that there is a much more consistent rhythm and spacing of the windows. On the theme buildings, the windows should cover a minimum of 20% and a maximum of 40%. It appears to comply, but I haven't done the math, but it looks right. It asks that window headers align horizontally with those adjacent buildings, but there aren't really any adjacent buildings, so that's not applicable. On new theme building facades, windows should be evenly spaced in the horizontal direction with no more than 1.25 window frame width between windows or from windows to building corners. And again, that appears to comply. New horizontal window groups should form rhythmic symmetrical patterns on the building. I believe that it does. Let's see. And then it talks about grouping of windows. You don't really have any grouping or ganged windows. Is that correct? I mean,
we don't. There are buildings I showed you in our slide presentation where we have put them together, but that creates a big square.
Yeah.
We typically like to see them separated. But we do put fairly large windows in our units. Again, people are inside a lot, and they like seeing outside, so we keep low window sills in.
It appears that, I'm jumping ahead a little bit, but that your windows are about a 3x5 or a 3x6. So guideline 9, upper floor window size and design. They should be of a size and design compatible with nearby buildings. They, again, appear to comply with that. We just talked about the proportion. 3 to 5 or 5 to 3. There should be some traditionally appropriate horizontal divisions within the frame, but not snap-on grills. You do show in the very top floor windows that you have, I think it's a 4:1 double hung.
We did divide those because of the sort of the principle of getting a little bit smaller scale up near the top now. We don't use snap-ins. We typically use the simulated divided light or the real divided light. Typically,
I missed that.
We use the simulated divided light or the real divided light detail that's provided by Marvin Windows, for example, so that you get a shadow line.
Okay, great. The width you discussed is about 3 feet wide, so that's good. You do have masonry sills and lintos?
Well, they would be masonry, stone, or precast, depending on where they are.
Okay. You don't have any brick, though, soldier quarters.
Well, when I say masonry, I mean, yes, we will.
There will be
some brick sills or even headers over the window in brick.
Okay.
And again, that's one of the methods of trying to not make each facade look identical to the one next to it. If you detail, we'll switch a little bit from one piece to the next.
And new window openings on a given floor should be no taller or wider than those on the floor below. It seems like they are consistently sized from floor to floor. You say that's true?
We're being equal to everybody.
Okay, guideline 10, facade materials. For theme and landmark buildings, wall surfaces which are invisible from the street should be predominantly brick. Stucco is acceptable for walls not fronting on a street. So I notice your front facade, the upper band, I believe, is stucco.
Well, it's probably drawn with that possibility in mind, but so that applies just to the street building.
And I guess what I would say to that is the street facade, you kind of have that front bay of the building blocked off, and you could just wrap the brick around that one little, that first front bay.
I don't think there's a problem with that. I mean, I wouldn't want to do that down 400 feet of building.
No, but just
the reason we have these four brick colors is so we can use that as a tool. We want to change the color up there,
mm-hmm.
probably to a lighter, or a little darker below, but we can do that with brick.
So I would say that front facade should be brick and then wrap the corner to mm-hmm. the next
right.
articulation of building change.
Yes, and then it will die into a wall around the corner of one bay.
It also talks about mortar joints. You haven't provided details at this point. I imagine that'll be something that'll show up in your final construction documents. But important to know the sizes that are indicated here and that the mortar color should not significantly contrast with the masonry in hue or darkness. Cornices guideline 11, decorative cornices at least 2 feet high shall be built on the street facade of the new theme building. We did show some very schematic details. It's not clear to me which cornice detail relates to which elevation, and only one of them appears to be close to 2 feet high, so we'd want to know that.
The taller ones are, in general, if you go to the two long elevations as well as the front, the taller ones are towards poly. And as we go back, you'll be able to see, they do simplify a little bit as they go back, because by the time we get back there, we're surrounded by single family houses. And I think really the intensity of downtown Northampton doesn't belong in the middle of the neighborhood quite that way. So we've simplified some of those details and lacked a little bit back there. But
I think that's fine. And we just want to know primarily, again, the street view from Holly Street.
Well, that stays a constant. It doesn't matter where we are in the building. We don't want to look at them. You don't want to look at them. We don't want the mechanical scene from the street.
Sorry, you don't want to look at what?
Mechanical units on the roof.
Okay. So the next item is for the cornices specifically, the new construction should respond to the small scale detailing of surrounding historic buildings by displaying stylistic, consistent, compatible detailing on street facades. So your renderings imply that there's small-scale detailing, but the details, again, are not yet provided.
I don't know if we can get this thing to work again, but if
I can't get it. I've tried it like six times.
Yeah, I don't know why we're getting this ad here, but we're getting the ad. And the presentation is still sitting here, but...
Yeah.
In the last time that you looked at our slideshows on that, I don't know if you recall this, but we had a series of slides in there where we showed you a rendering of a building. It's actually in Kirkwood, Missouri. And then we showed the scale model of that building. Those were done at the same place that we are in the project right now. No working drawings yet, no prices, no final. And then I showed you a slide of the finished building, and I did that because we're going to use this presentation to get people to say, yes, I'd like to live there, have my friends come see me there, and spend a fair amount of money on an apartment so I can be in downtown Northampton. We're not going to change the way it looks after that, or all hell will break loose. So you can rely on the appearance of these elevations in a substantial way.
And that's fine, and I think in general that the appearance is appealing and seems to generally comply with the guidelines. I'm just saying the level of detail that we normally see in order to approve a permit is not yet present. So that's all. I think you're on the right track.
Mm-hmm.
I just need a little more detail, personally. They may decide otherwise. Mechanical equipment, we talked about that. It'd be helpful if we actually had a roof plan so we could say yes. I don't know if when we are looking at the documentations and when we're provided with the PowerPoint presentation that has additional information, are we approving both, both sets of information?
Well, you wouldn't, the PowerPoint becomes part of the record as a presentation of what is being proposed. You can, but the permit will reference plans, not a PowerPoint presentation. So you can indicate that the plans need to match what was presented.
Mm-hmm.
So indicating exactly where in the roof the mechanicals will be as presented in the PowerPoint.
So those are all the guidelines and notes that I have on the project. If there are, should I open it up to public comment, even though there are not many public people here? Unless anyone else on the board has any additional comments?
Yeah, I just wanted to mention a few things. Just in terms of, Carol, in terms of reading the guidelines, where it says building setbacks,
uh-huh.
Now is that specific from the setback from the street to the building, or does that include setbacks in the building, like the front terraces just talking about?
No, so the primary setback is where the building footprint is,
right.
And you could have setbacks beyond that, but it's really about that sort of the first floor foundation area where the initial setback was taken.
So they're not restricted by our guidelines from doing that little plaza in the front?
No. No, not at all. In fact, there
the
was
upper plaza I'm talking about.
The upper plaza. Okay, so
not the, yeah.
No. That, because we would look at a building setback, we would take the measurement from the foundation wall, basically,
yeah.
Or the, you know, the first floor wall.
Yeah, so I just want to mention that since it's allowed by the guidelines, I like the idea of that, you know, upper plaza there. I think it's great to have a viewing space like that. It's a great public space.
We really enjoy it.
And again, I think design is somewhat personal in terms of everyone's view. And it was mentioned about developing the piers, but when I look at the projection, you know, the elevation of the whole building, because of, I'm assuming these different color buildings are a slight setbacks.
There's
where
some
each color bank changes.
Some
there's
change.
A, there's a subtle setback in that, correct?
Yes.
And I'd be concerned that if you added additional vertical piers to this, that it may become a very busy looking building. And I personally like the what you've done with this presentation at this point. So for me, I don't think the piers, the vertical piers are an issue to be of my concern. That's my
you're planning to have retail on the south side of the building in addition to on the plaza.
It wraps the corner a little ways, yeah.
I just wanted to be clear about that. I'm trying to think of what kind of details we usually ask for that aren't here.
Mm-hmm.
And we usually see window samples or were there window, actually.
The largest details are these details.
Do we actually have something that says what the windows are?
I think it's a aluminum clad window, or
they're metal clad.
Typically Marvin, is what you said?
Typically Marvin, that's where we always begin, and usually what we get. They're a good low maintenance window that lasts a long time, and they have fairly quality details that they offer as options.
So often an applicant will bring in, sort of like you have photographs of your bike rack, they'll bring in a cut sheet on the windows that you're going to use, so we can see a photograph and understand dimensionally what it looks like. It would also describe the simulated divided lights.
Yeah.
Just as a builder, I'm just curious, when you say use Marvin windows, like on these double hungs, are they integrities, or do you use the full line Marvin?
full line Marvin, and they typically, we have a few buildings with double hungs, although these are typically casement.
These are casements?
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Interesting. Is that, well, but you show a section here of a double hung. You have a window section with a double hung, David, on page A10. And I just assumed you were talking about double hungs in this.
No, probably not. Although there, as I said, we, you know, it's possible that could happen in one, in a building section to change the appearance. But the way we've drawn the elevations there, they could be done either way with casement or double hung.
Well, so what you're saying is if you, to use a casement, they have the meeting rail built into them, to them, to really.
Yeah, there's snap-on grills, which we all know we don't want to use. They break, they fall apart, they're not great long-term.
Well, I've never seen a snap-on grill that mimic a meeting rail.
Well, you don't get a shadow line and all that. So it's a simulated divided light or actual divided light. And Marvin often offers a whole variety of widths that you can get for that.
So you're saying you'd be using a variety of casement and double hungs?
Well, you can also see that we are changing the color of those windows as we go down. They aren't all the same. If you look in a section of building, you look at one a single color in that section, go to the next section, it might change color there, like it does downtown from building to building.
I'm just curious, is it a safety issue? Why do you not, your elevations here appear that these are all double hung windows. What is your intent to want to use a casement? Why do you want to use a casement if you mimic?
Because we have found that the ability to crank those windows out is easier than people up and down with double hung. But we've made exceptions to that as well, so.
Well, would the casements be door opening this way or the articulated this way?
Not the awning.
Not the awning?
No.
They would be.
Yes.
So, in other words, you would have to have a vertical element, which is not shown. I mean, which is easy. Right?
No, they would just hinge on the side.
Yeah. They would look totally different than these look.
You can get a casement that looks from far away, looks just like a double hung. It's just that when they're open, they're going to be sort of these fins sticking out of
the building. Yeah, it changes the whole appearance of a building once you're in operation. You know, exactly. You have all these things sticking out all over the place. That's what I think nice.
So
but
you don't like
it changes the smoothness of that facade.
Well, perhaps on the front facade, if they could be double hungs at least,
sure.
That would be my preference, and
yeah,
then
mm-hmm. Or let's
on
say
the long sides, they could be.
Or I'd say the front building, like
the front bay.
Just that first building, you know, you have like the
right, where it wraps around.
Just the wrap around on that one, I think would be.
We don't want to stop things at the corner. It looks funny.
I accept that.
You know the smaller windows that you have that are, are those operationally?
There's a few upper, like the square ones you're talking about up here at the very top.
No, those are in the center, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Near the center. That's a corridor area, and it's a connector that goes across. That corridor has only got units on one side of it. And so those look down onto the entrance area that where you come into the building.
Okay. So they're not operational?
Not operational.
Any more board comments?
Well, I'm curious what other details we want to see if we weren't going to approve this today in order to specifically what other details, like an example of the windows would be one that I would, that I'm used to seeing. But you know, I mainly asking that of you, because there were things you said that you wanted to see more detail.
Sure, well, so the things that I would like to see are floor plans, so that there's, we understand that.
We're not gonna do that.
At all?
No. We're here to get zoning approval so we can proceed with our project. We're not gonna hire architects, engineers, and do soil tests, and engineer the building all the way to the roof, and finalize floor plans to get zoning approval.
Well, this isn't zoning, this is the Central Business Architecture Committee.
I understand.
And so, we have asked other projects similar to your project for this amount of detail, and
We have a year's worth of pre-leasing that we have to tackle at a very, very high expense, and we will not proceed through that until we know we can do this building on this site.
And I think you're on track, and I think for me personally to vote to approve a permit from the Central Business Architecture Committee, or approval, that there are additional details that are required.
Well, if you can be specific, we'll try to give those to you, as long as it doesn't require doing all the architectural drawings and all the engineering and all the soil tests.
Let me ask a question. Were you expecting to get an approval, like an up or down approval tonight?
Yes.
Or was this more of another kind of informational meeting?
No, we need to move past this process and start doing other things on the project that won't take place anyway.
I heard the conversation earlier and your interest in maybe seeing floor plans, which aren't necessarily required. You indicated that you would be comfortable with a certain recess or projection, I guess, to create a shadow line. You could create a permit condition that says that it has to have, that whatever those elements are, have to meet a 4-inch or an 8-inch, and leave it at that. And if, as they go through the design, and it doesn't work for them, then they can come back and amend it. The window, just seeing the sample, I mean, they have a detail here about a double hung, so I don't know if that's enough for you to understand what window they're using, that there'll be some depth to that. But you could also specify that it can't be, you know, shallower than this detail that's shown. And then the issue about the case, you know, the double hungs around, I think those are appropriate conditions. And if there are, so I think maybe you can move through what you think are details that you might like to see, and see if what guideline you think that needs to meet, and then just set it and say this is how it's going to happen, as one way to address it.
Okay.
Well, I'm fairly straightforward. If there's something that you say you have to have, I'll say if I can't do it right now. If there's something that you request that's very doable, we will commit to that, and we'll be sure we follow it. It can be a condition of our permit set when it comes in, and we'll come back to you with that before we ask for that building permit, if you'd like us to do that as well.
Well, we do often ask to see the final drawings before the permit, the building permit.
Right. If you haven't seen satisfactory, then you can put all of whatever conditions you feel are appropriate for to meet those guidelines. If you think those are necessary to meet the guidelines, then you could say, you know, prior to submission of building permit, that they have to come back either to a designated person, the chair, or anyone else, or the full committee, just as a sort of final sign off. So you can decide sort of what level that needs to be done.
Okay. Let's try this again. I guess I would like to see floor plans or elevations that indicate where the setbacks occur and what the depth of the setbacks are in the elevation, and that they should minimally be 4 inches.
I think we've submitted that already.
Actually, sheet A7 and 8-6 does talk about offsets. I don't know if this is exactly what you're looking for. This says 12 inches to 24 inches. And I mean, if it's typical of every elevation, there's only two elevations shown, maybe that would satisfy.
And again, if you can be specific about what you want and don't want, we will do our very best to be sure you get what you do want. As this building goes back some 400 feet, is going to have a number of offsets, and some of them are going to be fairly large in order to get those larger apartments that I spoke of earlier. They'll be on the south elevation predominantly on the interior side. If you're specifically talking about offsets on the front facade on Holly, that's a different issue, and it's a much smaller issue. And if we're going to articulate that center bay a little bit more, let's decide right now, do we want it 8 inches? Do we want it just to be a 4-inch offset and a color change? And we'll do it that way.
Well, what are you proposing that offset?
But personally, I don't want it to be flush. I don't like that. I don't like flush. That's why we're breaking up the building all the way down the whole thing, not just out on Holly. I don't feel any great need for it to be a foot. 4 inches, 8 inches, I think would do just fine.
Mm-hmm. I would agree. So can we say 4 to 8 inches?
I'll do that.
So I'm clear. Are you talking about this setback right here?
This front bay, yeah.
On the back.
Mm-hmm.
So on the south elevation, can you say where the really large offsets are going to be?
Well, all of them are between 12 and 24 inches.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's what these notes are trying to say. Things are going to bump in and out because we have to have more than one unit size.
Right.
And the best way to do that is it also helps break up a very long, otherwise very flat facade. Mm-hmm. That 400 feet of flat brickwork would be horrible, I think, for the neighbors. If it had no physical.
I'm sorry, I can't read these numbers. Are these numbers telling you how far the.
Yes. Well, those
they
are,
stick out?
That, those are widths.
Oh, those are widths.
These, I think, are the notes that tell you the offset. And I think that was.
Yeah, so it says that 12 to 24 inch offset happens at these lines. So this whole bay sticks out. 12 or 24 inches from the other facade.
So when you say 12 to 24 inches, that 1 to 2 feet is the increase in the size of the apartment.
Yes.
Really,
the living room gets longer, the bedrooms get longer, it brings the square footage, you have more furniture.
Yes.
So the ones that say offset are going to stick out, and the ones that say setback are going to go.
Yeah.
All right. That's. Okay. Is there some way as a committee we can try to narrow down the things we want to see?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's what that's what I'm trying to do, but I wasn't. Yeah.
So it sounds like the setbacks along the side are acceptable to be 12 or 24 inches as indicated on the plans, and the only thing is the front elevation describing the center bay to be a 4 to 8 inches.
4 to 8. You have a preference?
No, I don't think so. You
are you asking, are you implying that dimension because of the guidelines or because we don't necessarily have to follow the guidelines if we, as a committee, decide that it would be better one way or the other?
I actually think you don't want it to go any deeper than 8 inches or less than 4 inches on a front facade.
Okay.
I think that would, especially proportionally for that bay, because you want. Whereas the 12 to 24 is kind of like whole building setbacks,
right. This
is within a facade, and I wouldn't want the break to be so significant that it looks like we're creating separate buildings, because then that narrow bay in the center would feel very weird, like a tower.
Well, and this front facade, you know, is sort of a size and proportion that it's similar to something sitting downtown by itself if it had no setback.
Mm-hmm.
But because of the what we're doing down below and up above, I think having an offset there where it changes color, perhaps brick color, would be fine. And I think 4 would be a good way to do it. Now, maybe 8, but we'd have to look at the detail of what happens when it gets down to the horizontal stone band business down there in the columns below.
The brick color would continue. This whole, it's not really clear from the rendering.
You know, it's tough with the copy machine. I mean, it looks pretty good in Photoshop when it's first scanned and run. And then
Can I, since we're talking about setbacks, I just want to wrap up on the third floor balcony. On the front facade, it seems in general that most of the community is in favor of that balcony. Okay, so I guess as part of whatever the final comments are in this project, that that is acceptable to the community. So we'll add that as a suggestion.
So from this plan, I would never guess that there was any casement windows in this project. Because when the one detail you show of a window shows a double hung window.
Let me put the question back to you in a little different form, perhaps. The appearance that we've given you there is what we want to see. Because we're going to take this same material and we're going to mark it like crazy with it for a year. We're not going to come back and start pulling things out of it later. We tried that once way a long time ago. It didn't go well. So let me just ask you, do you want double hungs, or do you want casements, or do you just care that it looks like that with a shadow line?
To me, the double hungs look attractive and are very compatible with what's downtown. Casement is really different, and I'm sure I wouldn't like it as much with casement.
Well, it wouldn't look the same if it was casement and the horizontal break came out of it. It would look different. Not going to make it different. It's going to look like that. Now, a minute ago, we said, well, maybe we do double hungs on the front and wrap the corner. That's a way to start.
Well, from the plan, it looks like you're planning to do double hungs all the way around. So you're just saying that you're not planning to do that.
I'm saying we have not always done it, but we can live with either one. And I would tell you I couldn't if I couldn't live with it.
And I think if, you know, aesthetically, if it's acceptable to you to provide double hungs on that front bay building, then that meets the requirements of what people see from the street. And the argument...
You're going to see the side
You will see the wings. You will. However, the argument that...
Come all the way around, come the corner to here. This would be this whole building.
Well, according to your plan, the whole thing's going to be double hungs.
Casements.
But, Joe, I think what he's implying is they really look like double hungs, those casements. The parting rail is... It's a physical section. It's not like thin.
A real rail.
Yeah.
It's just when it's opened, you would see it, and then that one, the southerly facade, is actually going to be primarily behind the church, you know, on the Phillips Place, and then behind those residential units. So, to a large extent, you're not going to see full on that extensive, that whole length of building, the same way you would see it. From Holly Street.
What I'm saying is, if I voted to approve this plan and the discussion of double hung versus casement had never come up, and then the building went up and I saw a bunch of casement windows there, I would be upset. And I would consider that the plan had not been...
Because of the open position, regardless of the horizontal rail, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But now that the subject's come up, we can talk about it, but I can tell you, if the subject hadn't come up and we had seen casement windows there, that could have turned into a disaster. I think. So that's...
Yes, I think.
A surprise.
Yeah, we don't want that kind of surprise.
And that was caused by the fact that you supplied a section of double hung.
Yes.
I saw that and made a logical assumption that the whole building is double hung.
I understand that.
Yeah.
You know, our very first building, and the one that we use as a prototype, these gentlemen have been to and eaten in and done everything else, it's all double hung. That particular window manufacturer is not around anymore, and we have had some difficulty, especially with our older residents with arthritis, getting those windows up and down. And so we have used casements, but we like the divided light appearance, and so we've used actual divided glazing. But if it's objectionable on the, you know, certainly the front, I think we agree, that's how we're going to do it. If it's objectionable for the areas back in the residential district to have casement, then I think it's something we can make work. Unless you want to provide us with a little flexibility on that subject.
Well, I'm glad we heard about it, because this is the kind of thing that can cause real problems. Because it's, but, so what, so in terms of your desire to see a floor plan, you feel that what we've said about offsets satisfies that? So is there, are there any other details that you feel you're not seeing that you need to see?
So clarification, I just like confirmation on the windows that we discussed, double hungs on the front bay building that faces Holly Street and the casements beyond.
I'm still not clear how you feel about the casements in the back. We're done with the front. It's going to be double hung.
I'm trying to figure out if we have enough information to vote on this today.
Okay. I would like to see a submission of a, even if it's a schematic roof plan, just implying that the mechanical equipment is in the center.
Can you live with me forwarding that drawing to Carolyn?
Yeah.
Okay. Because it's already drawn in CAD. So.
Sure. The cornice details. I guess what I would say about the cornice details is that the drawings imply that they meet or will meet the intent of the guidelines, but I would like to see a final detail. Is that acceptable to ask for that, Caroline?
Well, because it's a guideline, I think you should say what that dimension should be.
Okay.
So, you know, if you want, there is the detail showing the profile. Let's see. Where's that? I thought I saw a 2 foot.
Page 10.
Dimension. There was that, but also on the elevation. I think it's for the, right, so it's A7. It has it
2'4¼".
2'4¼", yeah. But I think I heard that changes as it goes around, so I think clarity about to what extent there will be that dimensioned cornice versus the if I heard correctly.
I guess
that towards the neighborhood it was going to be diminished.
So maybe you can just clarify for us right now what so you have a couple different parapet profile details, and I apologize if you actually did call this out on the drawings.
And those are typically precast or stone.
So where are each of these three parapet details happening? And most specifically, the Holly Street elevation.
Well,
for me, is most important.
The 2'4" dimension, I think, is the Holly Street.
Right.
Although it goes taller than that.
There's 2 feet on top of that.
In the center, it's closer to 3.5 or something.
Right.
Is there a standard that we're supposed to meet for parapet height throughout the entire building?
A minimum of 2 feet.
It should be
all the way around
here.
At least on
what's
visible from the street.
Just
yeah.
All
but it's noted that in the plan, so was that your intent?
That's the detail.
The one on Holly Street.
That it would be 2 feet minimum, all the way around?
2 feet minimum, yes.
Yeah. Okay, so it's noted
but not the 2 foot. There's some that are taller than that, that are 2'4" and up to 3 feet.
Okay.
So And that's not really necessary to hide that equipment as far back. It's 30 feet away from the outside wall of the building.
Right, but as long, but if it's on the plan and the committee is approving the plan and it says 2 foot
minimum,
then you have to keep that.
I don't.
Yeah, I still don't know. Oh, here it is.
But that, so that's different from the issue about the cornice detail though.
Well, I guess the parapet or the corbelling detail, it's not a complete detail. So 4A10 is cutting through the front parapet wall. And it looks like it is stone, but it doesn't really describe how that corbelling relates to the rooftop or anything, if that makes sense.
No.
So if you come, I can actually point to the drawing. It would be helpful to explain it to you. Mm-hmm. So this detail 4A10, this section through here, is looking through this detail right here.
The purpose of it is to show you that it's not going to be flush, flat materials. There's going to be offsets and shadow lines created by the detailing. Mm-hmm. But it's also telling you that it's going to be a minimum of 2 feet 4 inches above roof line.
Okay, so you're saying that somewhere down here is where the roof is.
The roof butts in
and
here.
And there's some, perhaps, some metal cap over the top of
metal
this.
Metal cap.
Okay.
I think we need a clarification on that upper story of the front building. You had a comment that it was
stucco.
But doesn't stucco qualify as a masonry material?
Not on a street elevation. I mean, so the guidelines specifically say...
I think we already said we'll do that one.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm just meaning that.
But I'm not sure stucco is masonry. Masonry units, it's in the family, but it's not
a cementitious product, but it's not a masonry.
When you apply with a trowel, it is it's a
different skill.
The stucco is going to be the upper bay. It was going to be this, but similar to the double hung window, sort of this front building is going to be all brick and the windows will be all double hung.
Well, this looks like it's brick. Well, actually, I can't have my reading glasses.
It's a similar color. You can't really, there's not a lot of.
We're not drawing on purpose. We're not doing working drawings. So we're not drawing. Okay.
So I would assume that this was all going to be working.
Well, it's going to be now. It's going to be now.
I have a few questions regarding the cornice and also the stucco. Is it real stucco is going to be troweled down with plastering lab and not that foam stucco?
Nope, not that stucco.
Okay. And then back to the cornice. I see some soldier courses and some dental molding. And is it going to be consistent throughout? Or because it just seems inconsistent in the drawings, so I was wondering.
No, it isn't going to be consistent. On purpose. We're going to try to make, it's going to be consistent when it's on a facade,
right.
But as you go down the building, this may not be exactly the same as that. Mm-hmm. Just like your buildings downtown change from one facade to another, it's part of making it not look all the same.
Yeah,
unless you say no.
No.
And then we'll make it all the same because it'll be cheaper. It'll save money.
Yeah, exactly.
I think the intent is to give this place some character and not make it like one big monotonous box.
Without getting too carried away.
So we haven't actually, unless there's any further, I know you want to vote on it, but we actually have to open it up to the public if there are any comments.
I was just trying to see if we were ready, if we had all the information we needed to vote on.
I think that we can vote on it and request some additional information be provided.
Right, and I can, if you'd like me to summarize that before you, what I have, and make sure that I have that before you make the formal vote, that would probably be helpful for me.
Should I open it up to the public?
Yeah, see if there's anybody.
Is there any public comment?
You don't want to ask for that, trust me.
Okay, then I'm gonna close the public hearing, and is there any further board discussion? All right. So Carolyn, you want to read what you have for us so far?
Yeah, so, let's see. Prior to requesting a building permit, final plan should be submitted that show minimally a 4 to 8 inch offset for the center bay on the front Holly Street facade, and 12 to 24 inch offsets along the side wall facade, the length of the facade. A final roof plan showing mechanicals centered on the roof. Double hung window shall be shown for the front building portion that wraps around the facade on the Holly Street facade. And casements can be used on the other facades. The upper bay of the front building shall be brick and not stucco. And that's all I have. Did I miss something?
Unless you want to include the, we're allowing the balcony setback on the front door.
Okay, so it could be approved with the balcony. Now, the only thing is, so when they submit, so then, you know, before you frame the condition, you all might want to have a conversation about who reviews the plans to determine that these conditions have been met, and whether you want it to come back to the full committee or just sign off from an individual on the committee with staff.
Can we issue the approval with conditional approval?
Yes, so you could issue conditional approval that says that final plans have to show these conditions, and that those shall be confirmed by staff and the chair, or if you wanted to come back to the whole committee in an administrative meeting just to confirm that that's what they're showing is in compliance with the conditions, you can. So it's up to you how you want to do that final sign off. Or you can say staff signs off, but I think that in this case it makes sense for a board member to participate in that evaluation.
Yeah, that would be very comfortable if you and the chair would do that sign off. If there's any question, then you bring us all back to the table.
So I, in my understanding, the plan as it's presented shows the mechanicals in the center of the roof, and that there's a guarantee that they're not going to be visible from the street, so I don't think we have to put that in a condition. And the plan as presented shows off the offsets on the south elevation of the building, so I don't think that has to be a condition. I would make a motion that we approve the plan as presented with the following conditions. First, that the entire facade facing Holly Street be brick. Second, that the center section of that facade facing Holly Street come out from the other side between 4 and 8 inches. Third, that we are willing to allow casement windows on the south elevation behind, except on would this be the westward section?
Yeah, the west.
Except on the first west section of that elevation. The others, at the discretion of the builder, could be casement as long as they look like what he's presented. And finally, that we would permit a balcony to be put on the fourth floor facing Holly Street at the discretion, assuming it looks like the supplemental drawing that was presented, but he could, he would have the flexibility to do either. And that finally, that when the final plans were presented, that these conditions would be signed off on by the staff and the chair of the commission.
Is there a second for that?
I would second that, assuming that it is picked up on all of the notes that you put down. Did we left anything out in the motion that you?
I don't think so, except what I heard Joe saying in his motion was that we didn't have to address some of those things because they're on the plan. So the only the conditions are only the items that are not shown on the detail. So to that extent, it's not all of the notes.
Can I have a second?
Still second.
Okay. All in favor? Okay. Any opposed? No. I think that that's it. Yeah, great. So.
Thank you. I think it would be very inappropriate if we considered a plaque out on the plaza that said, "You're standing here enjoying this great view of downtown because of the following individuals."
Yeah, so.
Thank you.
Well, I hope you can sell it. It'll be a nice improvement to
see. Yeah, that's there's a fair amount of work in that step, I'll tell you.
Yeah, it should be easy to find 60 people and want to move to North.
Gotta be at least 62.
Yeah.
62, excuse me.
It's been we coming through here for the first time. We hear stories from I'm a local guy, so I hear stories from other developer friends, and I was told wear flak jackets, wear Kevlar helmets, you're going to get beat up. And it really has been the opposite of that. We had unanimous approval tonight. The planning board had unanimous approval. So we've had it's been a good working relationship. But then again, we're not putting up a CVS or a,
the collaborative process of.
Not a hotel on Flashy Park. No, not that. Not that way. So anyway, who says no to grandma? Nobody says no to grandma.
Well, in the end, the collaborative process generally builds better.
That's the trick of this. And if you come in here with something cast in bronze, it's not going to work. If you come in with something that's flexible, everybody grabs their pencils, and you come up with something, at least the first go around.
I completely agree with that. And that's why we started with our neighbors. The city had not even seen anything from us. And the first time we went to the neighbors, they were really annoyed that we didn't bring
design
with us.
They were really, really mad. They were sitting in the Paris Center over there. Yeah. And I remember this woman saying, she kept screaming at David while David's talking, "You're supposed to bring plans, you're supposed to bring plans. We have to have something to push back on." If we brought you a gold-plated Taj Mahal building that was worth $50 million, you push.
You know, I was like. Well, I think by the end, though, 99% of them understood that if we were going to listen to them and take it seriously, we couldn't already have our plans. So we came back with the plans the second time. And,
Hey, I'm just curious. What happened with the driveway and the planning board? I think there was some issues about that little driveway.
Well, that one went well, too. We,
oh, yeah?
Okay.
We actually have additional business, right?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We had a meeting with our neighbor and her attorney, and we worked out compromises and solutions to issues and things that were on the agenda, I think, before we attended the meeting. And then when we got to the meeting, the attorney spoke up and said we thought we would have been on the right path and had confidence we would do what they said.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Best of luck. We look forward to seeing it go up.
Thank you. Need to figure out where that ad came from. It's still up there. I turned the computer off.
Did you put the quarter in the machine and make it work?
I don't know.
This is
the
right
thing. Well, it's not an ad. It's the program that runs the projection.
I just think it's great that you guys, you know, it's a total masonry building. I just give you a lot of credit for that. A building that's going to last and everything else.
Well, you know, when you own it, these buildings, I don't know if you've noticed, but if you're paying attention, these buildings don't get sold very often. Once you go through all the brain damage to get them out to the pole, generations, they're owned for generations, and boards after boards after boards. And so building with materials that you don't have to spend a lot of time replacing and taking care of is kind of a good thing when you get 30, 40, 50 years into it.
Our philosophy is do it right the first time.
Are these all rentals, or are some of them going to be condos, or are they condos?
There's no condos around. They don't own the unit. They don't really want to own it anymore. Their big motivation is they're getting rid of the house and all the headaches that go with it to trade that for more social activity and people to take care of some stuff. So they don't really want to own it. But we do have two ways of coming in. One is called a refundable entrance fee. They take some of the money from selling a house and buy their rent down by $1,000 or $1,500 a month. So it's a huge return in the form of rent reduction. Or they can come in and just pay a higher rent, invest their money at the bank, and pay the taxes on the 1% that they paid over there.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
So minutes from August 3rd.
Did we need both sets? Is there a set?
Are there any comments?
I'm sorry.
My only comment was they were showing a switchback ramp, and I asked it, why didn't they call it straight up? Sort of I need to find that document first. But on the first page, about halfway down, I had asked why they didn't provide a straight run ramp instead of a switchback.
Oh, right. Okay.
That's all. Yeah. So if there's no other comments, I get a motion to.
Except for Melissa asked about building setbacks in the beginning. Not boat.
I just don't know.
I could have spell checked and picked
that
up.
I might have said that.
Well, I'm surprised it passed spell check.
Yeah. Okay, and then change about to up. Okay. I get a motion to approve the minutes as amended.
I make a motion to approve the minutes as amended.
I get a second. Second. All in favor?
Okay. One down.
Submittal requirements. So, I honestly have not been able to read the emails that you have put together, specifically today.
And the other minutes too.
There's more minutes.
The May 11th minutes.
That was just for reference.
Okay. Oh, that was on, oh, okay, from the other, all right, okay.
Yeah, I had asked for references.
Yeah, I didn't realize that.
So, well, the only, so a lot of the things that you all discussed in the last meeting are actually in the criteria for submittal. They're just, I think there are two issues. Is one, they're located with the regulations, so when someone's applying for a permit, they might not read through all of that to get to their, through their application. So I think it's potentially relocating it, so it's very clear. It's also will fall on me to make, to police that, and make sure that applicants don't come before you until they show that. Sometimes we do get quite a bit of pushback about, you know, why do we need to submit photographs? This is a tiny addition. Why do we need to do X, Y, or Z? So it would really be, it's really probably an enforcement item, I think, for the most part. You know, you got some feedback tonight from the applicant about what they just weren't prepared to do. So that we do sometimes get some of that. I think the planning board has done a pretty good job of holding a hard line and saying, you know, if staff tells you it's not acceptable to move forward, then we're not going to hold a hearing until it's, you're ready to move forward. So I'm fine with that approach and being a little bit harder about, to police that. But also making sure that it's more visible, so it's not just something that people don't realize that they need to provide. And then there were a few changes, I think, based on the discussion. You know, you all asked about having things in electronic form,
mm-hmm.
And reducing the paper submission. So we can add that. And just clarify the photographic representation of existing conditions. And then the other thing that I suggested adding was a more clear delineation of the description of all the elements that are going to be modified. It's up to you if you think that covers it or if more information is required. And again, you know, I'm happy to do, I mean, the interesting thing is that there was another application that has come up that, for which we actually need to set a date here tonight. I sent out an email last week, I can't remember, about that. But that applicant was sort of pushing back on the requirements, and I went through the list having, you know, freshly heard from you all that you want much more detail and specificity and consistency with what's submitted. And that wasn't received so well, but I sort of held the line and said, well, I can't put you on until you provide this information. So,
we can't do our jobs if we can't see what it's going to look like. It's just, it's that simple, really.
So no go on the 22nd then?
Well, I don't know. I don't know if I have enough people yet for the 22nd. I put together a draft legal notice, but I think, Elon, you said you were not available. I think Joe is not available.
Correct.
So it's a very small I think, did I talk? It's the other Christian Science building. So the reading room you guys already reviewed. So now it's the main building that's staying with the church. They're doing a very small bump out, like I think it's 6 feet or under 6 feet.
If it were earlier on the 22nd, I could do it. I couldn't do it at 7.
What's earlier for you?
Like 5:30 or 6.
Okay.
Are you saying there's some resistance from the church to provide the information you need for that
review? No, from the designer. Because it's such a small project, they just want it. You know, they don't think they need to provide
that. But they need a building permit. And he's got, if he gets that far with going for a building permit, I think that would be enough for us.
From the designer point of view, it is a catch-22 if you want to provide a design that's going to get approved, and you don't necessarily want to go all the way through construction documents and then find out that it's wildly off. I think, you know, we've had three big multifamily projects come through of varying degrees of detail, this project being the least detailed of the three. So it is frustrating to get pushback from them when we know that a project of this size should have the budget available to provide the documentation for a permit. And I think that that should be a consideration. You know, if somebody's putting on a 6-foot addition versus a, you know, $50 million building, that's, there probably should be exceptions about what's required in terms of submittal. But I do think it's important that projects of certain scale, the submittal process should be equal. And when we require information from one group, it should be equally required by the other group.
Yeah, I mean, and I think in terms of this one specific project may be different depending on who the design team is and what the project is, but it was really sort of just another thing, like the photographs or the Photoshop mock-up of the, you know, proposed conditions were just, I think it felt like that was a bit over the top for them, although that's not that burdensome. I mean, the software's out there. It's, you take a quick photo and you're done, you know, it's pretty quick, so I'm not even sure that that's the kind of thing that would, you know, overly burden, you know, even individual property owners if they were doing it themselves.
Basically, we need enough information to have a clear understanding of what is being proposed. And so you need that, and then you make your approvals or recommendations, and then you need something for the record that says this is what everybody approved, so that when you stand in front of that building 2 years from now, you can say, wait a minute, you didn't do it properly. So everybody has to provide some basic documentation, and it could just be a couple of snapshots for a simple project. It could be something much more elaborate for something like this or some of the other things. But we need to know what there is, and if it's working with an existing building, we need to know what was there, what was proposed, and what was finally done. Mm-hmm. And I would also suggest that, you know, if you touch base with Sarah LaValle on the Historical Commission and the Elm Street requirements for design review, it would be good if there were sort of the same procedures to go through, so you don't have two totally different design review application procedures. I'm sure there would be some parallels. It would make our life easier on the Historical Commission, as well as life easier here.
Yeah, I think in some cases that might work. I think, mm-hmm. you know, your focus on that commission is...
basic things that you need.
Right, but you'll need a little more detail about historical context.
Yeah.
You know, I just, you know, I mentioned this to Carol, but I feel like we dropped the ball on that Masonic Street project, and that Peter's presentation was really not detailed enough, and that we let it slide. And I think we should, just like this, go through all the ordinances. I mean, for example, and I remember that meeting, Joe wasn't even aware of what the siding material was.
Right.
Peter Nathan. You know, and I'm kind of very disappointed. I'm looking at that building now, and I really resent that tower that they put on there. The way it's, the roof trim is, it looks like a movie set. It's like a front. You go around the side, and it stops. It really looks cheap. And also, I don't quite understand how they're dealing with, like, the roof issues, but the whole back facade, there's no overhang at all. It's just a flat corner there. And what is the roof going to just run down the back of the building? I mean, that's not art. Problem, but it just looks like they didn't want to deal with the back of the building, and it is, it's very visible from the street views, you know. I think there was some, we have a lot of respect for Peter because he has put some very thorough presentations in here, but I felt like that thing just got sloughed through here without, you know, and I think we need to be a little more aggressive about presentations, you know. I mean, he had no details at all, like everything that we just went through with these people. I mean, so anyway. And now we have no recourse that, with that building.
Well, if it's not, if you feel that it's different from what you approved and that there are things that are visible that were not presented as being visible and it's different than the way it was presented.
If you go back and look at what Peter submitted to us, I mean, those drawings were so tiny, you couldn't even see any details on them. They were like those 3D perspectives of from mm-hmm. them. That's all that was presented. And, you know, I just,
yeah. Okay.
You know, I don't see it. Peter, you know, I just think you're pretty cheaped out. I'll just put it that way. And considering it's a $500 million project, they could have squeezed in another few thousand dollars worth of roof trim, you know, to make it look complete.
Which property is that on the side?
It was the old reading room, Christian yep. Science reading room.
Yep.
And now it's being converted to law offices. And
it's possible that it will be applied later.
They're past the framing stage. I don't think so. Also, there was a chimney removed from the roof, and I don't know if you want to consider that part of what was accepted, but they took that chimney right out, too, for some reason. I mean, it's actually an improvement, but you just don't do things if it's already a presentation.
Right, but I think that may have been taken out. I don't recall the chimney on the plans. I can certainly look at that. Because that is a change.
Okay, well, getting back to the modifications, Melissa, you had written a couple of emails. I'm just curious if these modifications kind of capture what you were talking about.
Yeah, the only thing is I'm thinking that maybe we should go back to the guidelines document and update it. And whose job would that be? Would that be the committee's, or would that be Carolyn's? I'm just wondering. I know Walter was the one that did the initial guidelines.
So they've been updated periodically, and typically what happens is and it could be initiated by the committee, it could be initiated by staff, but we do the work typically. So if you felt that there were certain pieces that needed to be modified or updated, then you know, I would certainly take that under. It would be depending on I forget how the guidelines, I think, are approved and adopted by you all after a public hearing.
Okay.
So we would put it together, we'd take it for, you know, do a public hearing notice and make those modifications. There are some, I'll have to go back, depending on the specificity, it might need to go to City Council, it might just be within your purview.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So.
And then would you be able to make the modifications, or do we have to go back to Walter and he has to?
Oh, no, that's long. That was a one shot, one off.
Oh, good, okay.
Good. Yeah.
And then the other thing, I'm just curious about the whole process, because I don't want to go, Carolyn explained that, you know, we can't essentially be having meetings before hearings and things like that. So how are the communications, if any? How are they happening right now? And I'm just curious about the chair's position, because that's great how you have all those items that you go through and check them off. I mean, do we have roles about that, or can we just review it ourselves? And
well, generally, I guess sort of this format that we follow in terms of opening it up for board discussion, I generally like to go through the guidelines and do a checklist and make sure they've captured everything.
Mm-hmm.
For me, that's the way of making it equal between every applicant.
Mm-hmm.
And so as the chair, I feel that that's my responsibility to make sure we've touched on all the guidelines. But then I think in general for the rest of the committee, it's to, and I try not to, I don't want to influence anybody by speaking first. So that's why I always ask you all if you have comments first, and then I'll follow up with getting into the nitty-gritty and then additional comments. So there is a format in terms of how we go through it, you know, when we speak, when the public speaks, when a motion is made, etc. And that's also what I'm trying to guide us through in terms of the process. And then Carolyn's giving us any kind of advice about what we're actually allowed to do or not do.
But it's definitely not set up so that only the chair makes those determinations. So you know, any comments that, and I think as Alon's mentioned, is that it's her, I mean, that's sort of your way of making sure you feel like you've gone through it. And each of you might have your own way of trying to understand the guidelines and what you might want to, what more information you think you need from the applicant to understand what the project is. So it's really, there's no set, you know, way to do that. And then the, in terms of the communication, so when I send the only communication that can be done across board members is to establish meeting dates, basically. That's it. So no conversations about your interpretation of a project, your feelings about, or determination that there may be some things that aren't meeting the guidelines. None of those that reflect any kind of your thoughts about the project can happen outside of this public hearing setting.
Not prior, even prior to the opening of.
That's right. So if you have questions and comments and you want feedback from me, that's completely okay one-on-one.
Just with you.
Just with me. But not, you cannot CC the rest of the committee, because that can be interpreted as being a meeting that's outside of a published public hearing, because you're giving your feedback to the other committee members, and that might be generating some path towards a conclusion of one way, sort of
another. Even though, I mean, with the open meeting law, though, aren't all emails accessible to the public?
But that doesn't matter. They are accessible only when asked to receive them. The idea is open meeting law, you set a specific meeting date, and the meeting of the members is published in on an agenda, and there's a specific date and time at which everyone has the ability to hear what everyone else is saying. So that's why the email is not appropriate.
I thought it was okay to talk one-on-one about something, like, as long as we weren't talking to more than one person. So like if I'm walking down the street with Bruce, I'm allowed to talk to him about something. But if the three of us are walking down the street, then we can't talk about it.
Well, so it gets to be gray, because you know, you're right. It's not a meeting of people until you have a quorum. But then if Bruce sees another member and it's just them, and then he's been influenced by what you've said, there can be a chain occurrence of conversations that become a meeting, and that's been interpreted as a meeting. And so, you know, it may have, but the safest bet is to say nothing about any permit that's ahead of you until you're in this room. And if you happen to bump into each other and say something, then you come back to the meeting and you say, by the way, you know, we did say X, Y, and Z, and we're just disclosing it. But the safest thing is to not have any conversation with anybody or anybody in the public, because that could be considered deliberation.
So can't talk to applicants about any projects.
Not applicants, not your neighbors, not your friends.
Only you.
after the permit goes through, we can talk about it.
You can talk about it till you blue. Because the decision's been made, the hearing's been closed, and all that.
Yeah, exactly.
So getting back to, did that answer your question?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay. Getting back to these modifications, at least on the submittal process, I think it would be helpful if you said these are kind of folded into the guidelines, but if it could be somewhere front and center on the website, and if we get into revising this document, that be a section of submittal requirements. But minimally, I would say at least have it very clear on the website.
This is in the guidelines. I think that's the problem, is that people don't necessarily look at that. They go straight to the guidelines, so they don't really look at the submittal, right? So what I was suggesting is maybe so we have a separate page for application. So if you, and we have criteria about what you know, how many copies you need to submit for each board. So we could put a hot link maybe in there that takes you right to this list instead of listing it, you know, embedding it in that actual application form. I think, I can play with it a little bit, but I think maybe having something that's highlighted there as a link might be, might at least be helpful. We can also try it, and if it's not working, you know, figure something else out.
Might it make life easier for staff, the public, and all of us to have a fixed meeting date, say once a month, that can be, ended, or that you can call it off if there's nothing for the agenda.
Sure.
But just, you know, once a month, we know that it's going to be on such and such a date, and you can let the applicants know. You'll know what the schedule is. We'll have it on our calendars. And if you get the word, say, hey, we've got nothing to do, no meeting.
Yeah, we can absolutely do that. I think, for a while there were very few and far between. So we sort of left it as, as
right,
needed.
Yeah.
And in fact, I think that could also help with, I mean, we have that with the other boards, as you know.
Mm-hmm.
We have specific deadlines because the board meets on a certain day. Your submission has to be submitted at X time beforehand. That would likely be helpful in another way to police having exactly what you need to say, okay, well, here's the date. If you miss that, sorry, I can't put you on that agenda. You're going to have to wait three more weeks, as opposed to having sort of this moving date where they could, as soon as someone submits, I contact you and find.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that worked, but you may find that it's easier for you all to have a set date as well, because then you kind of can plan for that and know. So I'm totally open for that. If you guys want to set a date, you can talk about a day that works during the week, if it's the third Monday or Tuesday, whatever date is, good in the month, that's fine. And the only reason why I suggested the 22nd, just sort of coming back to this next project for which I have to schedule a hearing, is that it is so small and it also needs a planning board permit, and the planning board has nothing else on that agenda date, so I thought it would be good to get it done, and if it's not on the same time as a joint hearing, we could do it, the same date potentially. And if in the event that it makes sense to have joint public hearings for another project, we can always skip the regularly scheduled meeting and move it to the planning board meeting. So for the next meeting, if you want to think about dates that work for everybody, that's totally fine. You can just
the 22nd. You don't have a quorum yet.
I need to double check because I don't think I heard from everybody. I heard from, and you said you're okay.
Yeah, I'm okay.
You're okay, uh-huh. And you're okay. So I have Bob, Bridget says 1, 2, 3, and Melissa.
I may not be able to make it.
Okay.
There's a meeting I have scheduled that, and I got to see if I can miss it.
Okay. So, but Joe, you can meet at 5:30.
Yeah.
So what I might do is, if you could meet, can you meet at 5:30? So if I have 1, 2, 3, 4 for 5:30, at least
3 a quorum.
4. If I can get 4 of you, because you could do it 5:30 that day.
At 5:30?
Yeah,
at 5:30.
That just essentially achieves the same goal, and that they're just coming, and people are coming one day.
Fine.
Yeah. So maybe we would shoot for 5:30 then, and then I can count on at least 4 of you, and Melissa, if you clear your schedule, then that would be great, and you could come. And then, and that's the kind of thing I can send out an email. Okay, what day works for everybody, like, all the time? Just set your calendar from here until next year. So I can, send that out, and we can figure something out if that makes sense for everybody to have a standard meeting day in a month. Yeah, I mean, it definitely helps me too.
Okay, so these are, do we need to make a motion on the submission requirements?
Yeah, that would probably be the cleanest.
there someone who'd like to make a motion to approve the modifications to the submission requirements as proposed by Carolyn, and that they will be a hot link on the submission
page?
Yeah. Application.
So moved.
Can I get a second? All in favor? Good. I guess the other.
Wait, who did the second?
Bruce.
Bruce is always our second.
Am I?
It's easy.
Well, did we just vote for these red lines? Is that what you're saying? Okay.
Is that okay?
Just so I understand. Yeah.
And you see how easy it is to change. So if you decide to change your mind next meeting, that's fine too.
And I guess the bigger question, and maybe I don't know that this is something we can decide right away, but to think about is whether we want to look at updating sections of this guideline.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't even know where you start with that. Do you dive into the whole thing, or you just go section by section and make recommendations?
Well, yeah, I mean, you guys, I mean, what would be interesting is four of you have had a long time to sort of review these and see projects come forward, and so you might have an idea of are we achieving what makes sense through implementation of these guidelines?
The question is there something problematic about them? Are we missing something in a project because the guideline doesn't address it?
Or is it
I
not
don't think
clear
I've experienced
enough.
That.
And then for the two of you who are new, having fresh eyes on it, you might have a different perspective of what could be addressed.
Right.
And then that could also help. So I think maybe instead of going section by section, if things rise to the top that you think that are in your mind create questions, or you think you're not sure of that, maybe that's the starting point, and that might, have an effect of looking at other sections. But unless you think, I'm not sure that we need to redo the entire thing, but who knows? Maybe after going through several sections, things need to be modified. Certainly, I think we should be open to that.
Any modifications, don't they have to get passed by City Council?
Yes.
Before the business originally goes to the council.
Yeah. And so, there were a couple of things, things have been tweaked over time. Like we changed the thing about recently about the first floor modifications to transitional residential structures, that originally those were entirely exempt. Any modifications would be exempt. But then the whole issue of bricking up that window on King Street came up, and mm-hmm. Well, it was a transitional residential building, but do you really want to close up, window openings? So that was tightened up. So there have been things like that have taken place over time.
But how did those edits just get added into the guidelines?
Yes. So then those were made.
But it's just planning board or your
No, yours. So we initiated it. We brought it to you. Then we submitted to City Council, it got referred out for public hearing, you all held a hearing, City Council held a hearing, and then it was adopted, and so it's on the code now.
So, because I work well with deadlines, and we set, by November or December that we have all sort of reviewed it and come up with comments, does that seem reasonable to anyone?
Well, it might be, depending on how different people work, it might be better to, like, we're going to have a series of these systematic meetings, like mm-hmm. Just set an agenda, like, next meeting, let's look at anomaly buildings.
Mm-hmm,
next
mm-hmm.
meeting after that, we look at transitional. I can tell you, if you said, Bob Walker, go through all the guidelines and give me all, it wouldn't happen. I wouldn't sit down and do the whole book, but I could do a chapter a month. You know what I mean?
I would want to address problems as they come up, because I don't think we have that many problems with it, frankly. But
Except for that bad anomaly building that has turned into this new landmark building.
Right.
You're talking about the police station?
Yeah.
So what about which one?
The example of the anomaly building in central business that no longer exists, and now it's a landmark building, the police station. That's one of the examples.
Yeah, that was where that came from, because it's the old police station.
Right.
Well, I read through all these things, you know, when I was appointed to it, but, you know, it's a lot of detail, a lot of information, and since, you know, tonight was really the first time that we had anything substantial to actually talk about, and so it was helpful to go through what, you know, what you'd put together and go through the whole process, but, you know, I agree with you that it's probably better just because, even just timing-wise in our lives, to go through and read through is just, you know, it's probably be a little bit of overload, I think.
Yeah.
Do you do the staff report just by yourself, or do you have people in your office help you with that?
We have no people.
You're just your son, they're really useful.
Yeah, these especially were really helpful. I was waiting for the shoe to drop. Now I can blame you.
No. Just wondering how you did all that work.
Yeah. That's why I have all those typos in the in the minutes.
So I might have missed one of the last emails actually, but did they provide photographs of the site that we reviewed today, the existing site?
They provided them in the presentation, but not in the submission.
Well, and they had this whole book. Do you remember when they first submitted that had? I think the photos are in.
When I got all this stuff and I was rushing around, I didn't have a chance to even drive over there, and I was trying to remember the last time I was at the Polish church.
I never got the book, but we had photocopies of that.
Yeah, I thought so. They had to do a zoning board submittal, they had to do a planning board submittal, and they had to central business. I think they were a little confused about what needed to go with which board.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought that they had submitted the pictures, like one of these spiral bound, to you all. But it may have been just the general application. But they did present, nevertheless, they did present it in what you saw on the screen tonight were some duplication of photos that they showed at the previous hearing.
Okay. Yeah, that's pretty much all I requested, the existing photos, because I get confused which way is north, and a contextual image, you know.
The new building within the existing.
Yeah, where's north, and then I can figure it out from there. But
no, it's always good to have photographs of the context.
Mm-hmm.
You know, particularly for newcomers who don't know Northampton like the back of our hands.
I know, at times I was second-guessing myself, saying, wait a minute, is this a Breno or is this brand new?
Right.
During the presentation, so.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, so you want to look at section, maybe what I can do is just, I'm just going to make a note here about setting, so once we get dates for, you know, a date established, I can just, you know, if there's a permit for that date, we could also add on more discussion. Or do you think you want to set and come and meet just to talk about regulations potentially on that date? I mean, we can also decide that at, you know, a subsequent meeting, but I think the first step is to establish a regular meeting date and time, and then, you know, have a consistent agenda item to go over, you know, each meeting, take a little chunk at a time to look at the guidelines.
Okay. So do we want to try and figure out a date now? A regular date now?
Yeah. You guys are up for it?
I'm ready for it.
My preference would be Tuesday or Thursday nights.
Thursday nights may be more difficult because it's either a city council in this meeting or planning board and zoning board. We do have a hearing room up here on the city council night.
Tuesdays are better for me.
Yeah, Tuesdays are better for me.
Yeah.
Okay, so Tuesday.
Tuesday's fine with me.
Tuesday's Tuesdays?
Yeah.
Okay, so does it matter what time of the month it is? Second Tuesday, third Tuesday?
First Tuesday of the month.
Okay. If I could.
Starting on October 4th?
And 7 p.m.? Is that what you're thinking? Does that work?
Can anybody do it sooner? I can do it at 7, but if you guys can do it sooner.
Yeah, or 6.
Sooner is always better, but.
Okay. So 6?
How's your life run? I mean, do you go home and have dinner, come back to these meetings, or you just work?
Thanks for asking. Actually, typically, I run home, get the kids settled, and then.
Yeah, but something like a 6:30 meeting might be hard for you, or a 6:00.
6:30 is definitely easier than 6, but, you know, once a month, it's fine. I mean, if 6 works better.
Would 5:30 be good?
That swings it a little bit worse.
Right.
Yeah, so.
Well, 6:30 would be okay.
I mean, but I could also do 6 if that's easier for you guys.
Kind of flexible.
Yeah, whatever is easiest for you.
Yeah.
Why don't we do 6:30 then?
Okay.
That's a happy medium for everybody.
I'd agree, thanks.
So we were, you say tentatively the first or the second Tuesday?
First?
First Tuesday, right, okay.
So starting October.
So we'll just say October 4th, we'll plan one and see what happens.
And then if you guys, the four of you, could put in September 22nd for 5:30, that would be great.
Okay.
And then we'll have, and even on the, so I'll wait till October 4th, maybe to see if, A, if we have a permit, and B, if you still want to meet and start looking at the guidelines, because everyone will be there as opposed to the September 22nd one.
And for the October 4th, should we set a goal of looking at Section 1 and Section 2?
Hold on just one second.
You have something on October 4th?
No, I need, are there any resident Jews in the room? Isn't Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur at the beginning of the month there?
Rosh Hashanah is the third, the day before.
Of October?
Yom Kippur is the 12th.
Rosh Hashanah is October 3rd?
Mm-hmm.
We're not.
Yom, Rosh Hashanah is October 3rd, but that, it ends in the evening. Unless you observe both days.
Well, yeah, so if you're really, if you're good, you observe both days or just one? Are you still in if you just do one day? I mean, what I'm getting at is, we're not supposed to hold meetings on the standard, on the day, the holidays, and so typically, does it end at sundown then on the 4th?
Right.
So with that, in October, I would say 6:30 is probably not sundown. So I don't think we can meet that day, so we would.
About November 1st?
Yeah, is that the first Tuesday? Yeah, we're clear of the holidays then.
Is that election day?
No, 8.
No.
8, okay.
Wait.
On the 22nd?
So we're not meeting on the 4th, October 4th?
We can't because of the holiday.
Okay, okay.
So it would be the next one. So November 1st. And we're sure it's not election day, we should all know that, right? I'm on a need-to-know basis, when it gets closer, fine.
Yeah, the 8th.
From the 22nd meeting in September, is that, what's the time on that, to be sure?
5:30.
It's 5:30, right?
Yeah.
Any other business?
So on November 1st, should we try to get through Section 1 and 2, which is 10 pages of reading?
Can I have one?
Would you remind us of that in an email?
I'm sure you would.
Okay, is that all the business we have?
I
perhaps you'd entertain a motion to adjourn.
I would.
I would move to adjourn this meeting.
Can I get a second?
All in favor?
Bruce wants a second.
No, that was not.